Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Jai 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 Krishna, Krishna, Hari, Hari, Hari Rama, Hari Rama, Rama Rama. Which interferes with our pleasure.
the great enlightened sages and our Vedas and all the great scriptures of the world teach the origin of that Ananda Vyokyashat is the source of life. Wherever there's life, there's a part of God. The Atma, the living force within everything, that consciousness that's seeing through our eyes and hearing through our ears and tasting through our tongue and smelling through our nose, thinking through our brain and loving through our heart, that conscious force is Satchitananda. Its nature is eternal, full of knowledge, and full of happiness. And his body is compared to a particular type of vehicle, just like we ride in a car. Sometimes you drive in a Honda, sometimes in a motorcycle, sometimes in a Ford. But we're not the car, we're the driver. According to what we can afford and according to our particular taste, we get a car. The car needs gasoline and oil. If you don't put it in, the car is going to break down. But the driver needs something else. The driver has its own independent nature. And similarly, the Atma, the living force within all of our hearts, which is eternal, full of knowledge and full of happiness, is seeking the awakening of that happiness. When we become completely consumed in this dream state where we think we're just the thoughts of this mind and we think we're this body, and we spend our whole life chasing all these temporary, flickering experiences in search of what's within us. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna tells that real intelligence is to rejoice and find one's happiness within oneself. And when we find it within ourselves, then we want to share that with the world. Through whatever we have and whoever we are and whatever we can do. Vidyabhanaya sampane brahmanikami. My Guru Srila Prabhupada would like to quote this verse. And I also like to quote it. Because it explains what real knowledge is. True knowledge is to see every living being with equal vision. Whether one is male, female, black, white, red, yellow, brown, whether one is a human, or an elephant, or a cow, or a dog, wherever there's life, there's a sacred part of God. When we realize our own spiritual identity, then we naturally recognize that in everyone. If we don't perceive it in ourselves, we cannot really perceive it anywhere. The real sisterhood and brotherhood of all living beings is a byproduct of self-realization. That realization. Thakur Bhaktivinoda, a great saint, he had 10 children. A wife who was as great a saint as he was, Bhagavati. During the British rule over India, he was a magistrate. Which means he was a judge. And he was the best judge of the British regime in India. They would give him the most difficult cases because he was so thorough and so precise and he had such intuition. But yet, Swamis, Babas, Sadhus, and the Kami people, villagers, scholars, they would all stand in line to give blessings and learn from him. Because he had such a pure and compassionate heart. He explained that the true testimony of love of God is not just what we say. If we actually discover that love within ourselves, within our hearts, then it is expressed through compassion. Genuine compassion for all beings. A saintly person is Paraduka Dukhi, which means another person's happiness is my happiness. Another person's suffering is my suffering. When that experience is on a spiritual platform, even our suffering is a type of ecstasy. Because it's not based on ego or selfishness. It's based on genuine compassion for the pure souls of others. The Bhagavad Purana tells, when you put water on the root of a tree, that water naturally extends to every part of the tree. The flowers, the twigs, the branches. And similarly, when we discover that origin of love, the love between the Paramatma and the Atma, the love between the soul and Bhagavan, or God, whom we call Krishna, which means all attractive, or Ram, who's the source of infinite pleasure. When that love is awakened within us, it naturally extends to all beings. This, according to the Gita, is knowledge. And whatever is connected to that state of consciousness is truth. Saintly people, in whatever walk of life they may be, this is what they really value. This character, these values. The world is so distracted by things. There's a saying that in a spiritually evolved society, people love people and they use things to serve people. But unfortunately, all too often in the world we live, people love things and they use people to get them in. I was asked to tell her one particular story. When I was traveling in 1970, hitchhiking from London to India, it took about 6 months. Recently, I told the story of my hitchhiking to India from London at the University of London. There was a few hundred people there. And one girl came up to me after the class, and she was really excited. She was maybe 22 years old. Very full of energy, full of excitement. She said, "I really liked your class. Do you know why?" I said, "Why?" She said, "Because I am the president of the All England Hitchhikers Association." She said, "I want to take a group on the same route that you do. Can you give me advice?" No. In my sadhu and 30-some years of being a swami, I've come to learn that there's a huge responsibility. responsibility when people ask you for advice. So I closed my eyes and said a little prayer to my Krishna. Should I tell this girl? And I got inspired. I said, you should take your group and hitchhike to Heathrow Airport. And then take an airplane to India. Because going through Turkey, Iran, Afghanistan, and Pakistan through the Khyber Pass is especially a nice blonde haired girl like you are. In Afghanistan, a place called Kandahar. Have any of you heard of that? Years later, it became the capital of the Taliban. But in those days, everyone was really nice there. They were very kind. They smoked a lot of hashish. They were very peaceful. Everybody who was traveling in those days, because there was a whole counterculture of hitchhikers. There wasn't that many people, but there was a group of people that would just had very little or no money and would hitchhike around the world. And every now and then we'd meet each other. And everybody would talk about how nice the people of Afghanistan. This is before the Russia invasion. So I was sitting in a little tea stall. There were no tables, no chairs, just a dirt floor and a little straw hut. And there was about five or six Afghani gentlemen, very poor, just crouched down on the dirt floor drinking tea. And one of them invited me in. So I was crouched down next to him, drinking his tea. And this 16-year-old boy came in. He was wearing rags. He was so thin due to hunger. He had a little rustic instrument with one string that went across it. Little turban that was wrapped around his head. But what really affected me was his eyes. He was blind. And his eyes were grossly disfigured and swollen. And he had nothing covered in it. And I had never seen anything like that. Made my heart quake. He just sat on the floor and started playing the string instrument. Just kind of went boom, 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 boom. And sang. Didn't have a good voice by musical standards. But he was crying out beautiful prayers to his beloved God. And as he was singing, his face lit up with joy, smiling, such a smile, such a contagious blissfulness was emanating from him as he sang, that all of us sitting next to him were totally enthralled. It was pure joy. And I remember thinking, what a culture shock this was. Because being brought up in America in the 1950s and 60s, I came to believe that in order to be happy, you should be healthy. You should be wealthy. You should have a good education. But this boy, he was illiterate. He was disfigured and diseased. He was in total poverty. But he was the happiest person I'd ever seen in my life. I wanted what he had. This was a turning point in my life. I really began from the core of my heart because I was all alone. And nobody else anywhere around spoke a word of English. So I was quite contemplative. I was thinking, what is happiness? What is it I really want in my life? It's that joy of love that's within us. That natural craving or our love for the Supreme, for God, for Krishna, there's many names. The awakening of that love is the greatest wealth. It's the greatest health. It's the greatest treasure. And nothing can take it away from us. Not time, not death. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, when speaking about that a few minutes ago, he sang a beautiful prayer, and there's one line. Krihe tako, vane tako, sadahari pole tako, suke duke pulo nako, varane harinam gorode, kai gora madhu sware. Whether we are with a family, husband, wife, children, doing business, or whatever, or whether we're swamis or sadhus living in the forest, by chanting these beautiful mantras, these sacred names, the real happiness of the heart is awakened. And we can perform our duties in such a way that we're no longer desperately trying to get something, hold on to something to give us happiness. Because the Gita explains that these desires that emerge from the ego, from forgetfulness of our true identity, these desires are like fire. You can't quench a fire by putting fuel in it. It just gets bigger and bigger and bigger. But when we find that, and that's what yoga is actually about, Ishwara Pranidhana, to find that love within ourselves, and then to express it, to share it, with that spirit of love for others. It's the greatest need. Lord Chaitanya told a story about a hunter. And he used to find joy in torturing animals. Not just killing them, but killing them in such a way that it was real slow and caused them the maximum pain. Why would anyone enjoy that? It's because his ego wanted to be the controller, the predominator. That I could cause such an experience of such intense suffering by my will. This predominating ego. To different degrees in all of us. As it was a great bhakta, Narada, a saintly yogi, he was walking through the forest. And he saw rabbits and squirrels and deers in so much pain. They were dying. They were just laying there struggling and struggling. And he's wondering, who is so cruel? And he saw the hunter. His name was Bagrami. And he went to him. First of all, Narada, by his mystical powers, took the arrows out of all of these animals and made them all right. And Bagrami was so angry with them. He said, why are you spoiling my day? Narada said, do you know that there are laws of nature? The Bible tells, as you sow, so shall you reap. Newton's law of thermodynamics is, for every action, there is an equal corresponding reaction. What they say here in the streets of LA is what goes around comes around. But this is the law of karma. If you give happiness to someone, you're going to get it back. If you give pain to someone, you're going to get it back. Whatever. It's the way the universe works. It's like the laws of gravity. Whether you believe it or not, what goes up must come down. So he explained this to me. Don't you know that all the suffering you're causing to all these other living beings is going to come back on you? He said, but I'm doing it for my family. So they're going to share it with me. Narada Muni said, go to your family, ask them if they're going to share it with you. He went to the family and they said, no. We're not going to share anything with you like that. When he understood what his destiny would be, he became very humble. He said, what do I have to do? Narada Muni said, break your bow. Don't cause harm to others. He gave him the name of Krishna and the name of Ram to chant. This will awaken the real joy that you're looking for. And don't cause pain to others anymore. By that satsang, by that little bit of association with the sacred person, Bagrami became such a compassionate person. He lived his whole life as an instrument of God's compassion to all beings. That transformation is the real purpose of life in whatever state we're in. That's the heart of bhakti. In music, there are so many songs about love. Yes? It's usually about the pain of broken heart. And sometimes about the joys of the temporary experience of God. Why is that? Because really that's what everyone is looking for. When I was at Narayan's house the other day, last year, I told a story about a lady who I actually just met recently. She was how many of you have heard this story? How many of you have not heard this story? Should I tell this story? Last year, I was driving to the airport in Bombay to come to London in America. And whenever people drive me to the airport, that's usually when they want me to resolve the most serious problems with our conscience. So I was
morning my flight, and people started telling me all these problems and wanting solutions. Because it's the last time they're going to personally talk to me for many months. So I said, tell me stories about Krishna, nothing else. So this one boy in the back seat, he said, just a few days ago, I heard this special story. It was International Women's Day. And this is just a year ago, and for those of you who see the news, there was huge demonstrations and riots in India demonstrating against the rapes of young girls. So it was a serious matter, this International Women's Day. There was an auditorium in a college very close to our hospital, Bhakti Vedanta Hospital. And very distinguished people were invited to this. There were politicians, there were industrialists, there were business people, educators. And some of our doctors were there. And they told the story of this keynote speaker. Her name was Sindhu Tai. She came to the podium with a simple sari and told the story of her life. Everyone was weeping throughout the story. She explained how she was born in a very simple, downtrodden village in Maharashtra state. When she was a little girl of about 7 years old, she wanted to go to school so much. She wanted to learn and get out of this condition of poverty. But her parents told her she had to take care of buffaloes. She's just a little tiny girl with a stick. And you've seen water buffaloes? And she just had a little herd of buffaloes, and she herded them around, and in the heat of the sun, at a certain point, buffaloes like to go in water and submerge themselves up to their neck. And when they would go into a pond of water, she would run to school. And when she was at school, she'd always come late. The teacher would regularly beat her with a stick for being late. Then after some classes, she ran back to the buffaloes, and oftentimes the buffaloes were grazing on somebody else's property. So they would beat her with sticks. She said, those were the best years of my childhood. When she was just about to celebrate her 10th birthday, she was still 9 years old, she was married to a 30-year-old man. And by the time she was 19 years old, she had 3 sons, and she was pregnant. At that time, there was a type of mafia person in that village. He was exploiting. He was forcing these village ladies to work for him. Hard labor, and paid them practically nothing. She actually reported him to the district collector. He's in charge of the police. And they actually stopped that man from his atrocity. But he was so angry that this young girl interfered. And he went to her husband and said, she's cheating on you. She's having affairs with other men. In fact, she's regularly having affairs with me. And the child in her womb is not your child. It is my child. And if you don't kill her, I will kill you. The husband was so angry. It was all total, vicious lies. came to his little wife, who was 9 months pregnant, and kicked her repeatedly in the stomach until she completely lost consciousness. He was sure she was dead, so he dragged her body to a cow shed where there were big bulls and cows just crowded in. The idea was people would think she got trampled by cows. There was one cow, a mother cow, who stood over her and wouldn't allow any other animal to come near her. She protected her. And even that man and his relatives wanted to come to see if she was actually dead, and the cow chased them away with her horns. For hours, that cow stood right over her. Under the cow that she gave birth to a baby girl. And she explained, she took a rock to cut her umbilical cord. And she was so beaten down from giving birth, brutally kicked. She lay there for hours and hours and hours and just saw the cow protecting her. Otherwise, she would have been trampled to death for sure. And when she finally got strength to get up, she embraced the cow. And she made a promise. She said, as you protect, as you helped me when I was helpless, I am going to dedicate my life to helping the helpless. Promise you this. She went to her biological home. But they had such an archaic tradition there that once a girl was married, they cannot come back to their former home. So they rejected her. And she has this little tiny infant girl. She's homeless. And she had nothing. So she was thinking, because she was young, if she's all alone and homeless, she'll get exploited, she could be raped. Where is she going to go? She went to the crematorium to stand on the bank of a river, open the sky, for people body. She would collect the wheat, mix water in it, and make chapatis, or bread. And the stove was the burning bodies. That's how she lived. It became so frustrating, she came to the point where she decided to commit suicide. So she went to the railway tracks and laid on the tracks with her little baby in her arms. She didn't want her baby to live this kind of life. And as she was waiting for the train to come, she heard somebody crying for help. So she got up and found an old man was crying for some water and food. She went out and begged for some water and food and brought it back to him, and he was so grateful. And she said that she'd heard her Lord. She heard God through that man telling her that she has a purpose that she can achieve in her life to help others. And she remembered her promise to him. And she went to a field. And she was just sitting under this field in the noonday sun thinking, how am I going to help anybody? What do I have? But then she noticed something. She was under a tree. And a woodsman with an axe chopped a branch of the tree very brutally. And that
by a shred. But it was giving her and her baby shade. And she thought, that is God's message. However beaten I am, I can still do something for others. She started going around to find little children who were homeless, which is very common in India. And she became their mother. She had a whole band of little orphans that she would just take around and sleep under trees, and she learned to sing really nicely. And that's how she went to bed. She would sing songs about Krishna. People would give her some donations. And after some time, people took note of it, and they built her an orphanage. After some years, she became famous as the mother of the orphans. To this date, she's had over 1,500 children that she mothered. She's won over 270 awards she's been given. She's been invited to about 20 countries. She has a couple thousand grandchildren. And even the Prime Minister of India and the President of India were. She's about 63 years old. Then she said, but I want to tell you the one thing in my life that gave me the greatest fulfillment. She said, this was my greatest accomplishment. One day, this 80-year-old man was homeless and helpless, came to her orphanage and begged for help. And she looked at this man, and after a while she recognized him. This was her husband, the one who tried to kill her, the one who left her to die. He asked forgiveness. She forgave him. She said, I'm no one's wife anymore. You want my help? I'm your mother. So he was so helpless that he accepted her as his mother. And she took care of him for the rest of his life. And she told the other children, she said, you should be very nice to him because he needs your love more than anyone. And when people would come and visit the orphanage, sometimes she would tell them that this is my eldest son. And sometimes he's very naughty. So I heard this story, and I looked it up. It's actually her story on the internet and everything. There's been all of her sons, they left their father after some time and came to live with her. Two of them got PhDs. One of them did their thesis on her life. So I gave this talk at Narayanji's house. How many films is it? And someone videoed it and put it on YouTube. And somehow or other, she saw it. This is the part that you didn't hear. She was really excited about it. She was watching it with all the orphan children and everything, and telling her story in America, in Hollywood. And she got the journey home. Marathi language.
But she doesn't speak English, and she had the whole journey home. And she was so thrilled. And she wanted to meet me. So I was in Vrindavan with 5,000 people on a pilgrimage. And I was just, last year was my father's 90th birthday. So I was going to come back, and my beloved friend Gary, where is Gary? He's back there. He came to Chicago to meet for that event. So I was thinking that it caused my father so much distress in my life. I should be there for his birthday. So I was leaving Vrindavan after I was giving a lecture, and I got a call from Sindhubai. It didn't come to my phone, it came to somebody else's. And she said to me, she said, whatever I've done in my life, it's only because of my faith in the grace of God. And she said, I call God Krishna. I love Krishna. And she said, reading your story, she said, I feel Krishna in you. And I wanted to be nice to her. So I said, Sindhutai, hearing your story, I'm feeling Radha through you. And she got really strong. She said, no, I'm not Radha, I'm Yashoda. She said, I'm no one's lover, I'm only a mother. So I was very happily defeated by her. Of about 7,000 or 8,000 people, and I was supposed to speak, and she was supposed to speak. They invited her to speak. But before that program, we met at somebody's house. It was our first meeting together. We spoke for a while, and she was telling me about how much Krishna's name is, and Krishna's love is so much a part of her life, and she's telling some stories. She told another story. She said when she had this little infant baby. Can I tell another story?
Yes.
This is before her orphanage. She was just with that little infant. She begged and got a bus ticket. And she went to get on the bus during the rainy season. And because he was in such rags, the bus driver said, we don't want beggars on this bus. She said, but I have a ticket. He said, no, you cannot be on. She was like fighting with the driver. I have a ticket. You have to let me on. He said, no, you have rejected. So there was this old man who told her, don't go on the bus. Just don't go on this bus. But she was ready to just force her way, so she didn't get on the bus. That's what she told me. And the bus took off, and a half a block later, a lightning bolt hit the bus, and everyone on it died.
Wow.
And she showed me a burn on her head that actually came from that. But anyways, we talked for a while. And then it was time for us to go on the stage. And it was this really energetic girl, maybe in her 40s, who was sitting next to her. And this girl was, didn't say a word. We spoke for about an hour. She didn't say a word. She just looked so blissful, full of energy. And just when we were about to leave, she said, oh, I forgot to introduce you. This is my daughter. She was born under the cow. And she's a medical doctor.
this story gives us a sense that however hopeless and difficult things are, the real beauty of life that nobody can take away from us is the will to give and the will to love. As long as we're just expecting. There's so many impediments to our happiness. And the origin of that will to give and that will to love is in the soul's divine connection to the all-attractive, all-beautiful. When my guru Srila Prabhupada came to the West, Chamasunda was there to meet him at the airport in San Francisco. He was 71 years old. The first airplane he ever took in his life was from New York to San Francisco. And when he came off the airplane, he gave a really nice little analogy. He said, when it's cloudy, you can't see the sun. But when you go above the clouds, the sun is always shining. So similarly, these clouds of misconceptions, the clouds of ego, the clouds of selfish desires. But when we rise above these clouds, then Krishna, or God, the all-beautiful, divine person, is shining for everyone, always. And to be an instrument of that light, the highest purpose and greatest happiness. It's something that we realize is forever. This chanting of Kirtan is a sublime, powerful, blissful way of awakening that light, that love that is within our hearts, that compassion. Recently also I was in a forest called Jharkhanda. And that's where Sri Chaitanya, who was Krishna himself, an avatar who appeared in this world. Through the chanting of God's names, he induced not only every type of human person, but even tigers and deers and snakes to awaken their love of God. Now in the jungle, tigers and deers are natural enemies. For obvious reasons, tigers eat deers. So tiger just sees a deer as food. And the deer sees the tiger as death. But through this chanting of God's names by the grace of the Lord, and the tigers paired off with the deers to dance. Now you may think this is impossible, but everything in this world is impossible. How you grew from a little seed. The little seed came from your father and to your mother, and they didn't have any engineering plan. They didn't even know you were there. And you start growing, little eyes, little ears, little heart, little lungs, and pancreas, and all this stuff. How do you do that? It's a miracle. Every tree is a miracle. Little seed becomes a tree. Every cloud is a miracle. The water is evaporated from the sea by the sun, and it's all salty, and it comes and it showers. It's pure water on our crops to grow food. So if the creator of all of these miracles could do that, he awakened this love, and the tigers and the deers were dancing. And the beautiful thing about this dance is they were embracing, and the tigers and the deers were kissing each other. No, I'm not saying you should do that. Because they saw each other in their eternal spiritual identities. They love and compassion. So in the world today, there's so much prejudice. There's so much egoism. There's so much depression. Because we're identifying with these temporary conditions that our bodies and mind is in. And we're seeing everybody else accordingly. Wars, hate, crime. And on one level, we have to deal with that through law enforcement and through education. The actual solution that every saint that has ever lived throughout history has told us is the awakening of our real potential of love, of compassion. This is the power of the chanting of God's names. This is the heart of devotion. Thank you very much. Would you like to dance like the tigers?